welcome to Connie Martinson Talks Books. My guest today, Gregory Orfila, has written Journey to the Sun. Well, who was the sun? I'll tell you, and it's not S-U-N. It's Junipero Serra. Wherever you will go, in Los Angeles, California, San Francisco, Monterey, San Diego, Juniper Serra was there building monasteries that are really statues and celebrations to his name and to the church. This is his story, and it is subtitled Junipero Serra's Dream and the Founding of California. The book is published by Scribner. Welcome, Gregory.
Thank you, Connie. Good to be here.
And truly, reading it, it's like a novel, a historical novel.
Thank you.
So, we begin with a little boy born in Majorca, Spain. When did he join the church?
Well, Serra came into the church with when he was baptized, really. He was baptized Catholic, very close, if not on the day of his birth, which was unusual. And the reason for that is that two of his siblings died before he was born. So there was some fear that this one would go too.
Yeah.
And so they baptized him, like I say, the day he was born.
Yeah. When I said that, I meant in terms of when did he become a priest?
Oh, okay.
Yeah.
Yeah, priest would be, I believe he was finally ordained at the age of 25.
And then he's in his early 30s. Joins or is assigned to go to the new country, the new Nueva Mexico, Nueva Spain.
Right.
And on the one of the worst trips that one can take on a rough sea, he finally arrives.
Yeah, 3 months on the Atlantic, also going through the Caribbean. He stopped in Puerto Rico, and they finally get to Veracruz in late 1749. And as you know, Connie, they ran out of water. And I think Serra, who had this sort of dry humor, said, talk less, save saliva.
Right, right. And from there, he does get off and he walks.
Yes.
He walks to?
Mexico City. Yeah, he, and that's when he gets his spider bite. You know, it's interesting, in the there's been several biographies of Serra over the years. The first was by his best friend, Francisco Palou, in 1787, 3 years after he died. And in these, in the one biography, that early biography, Palou says he was bit by a mosquito, zancudo. So I asked my doctor, who teaches medicine at Georgetown University, he's a pretty good guy when it comes to these things, could a mosquito bite, ulcer, necrotize and ulcerate and hurt you for 25 years and make you almost lame? He said, no way.
Yeah.
Probably a spider.
Yeah. And not only that, but his leg has been cut.
Yeah.
He has fallen and had the leg cut and it ulcerates.
That's right.
And on this, he walks thousands of miles.
Yeah, he did. It's a bit of a myth that he walked everywhere. He did take mule at times. He did take a boat. Probably not a horse. Franciscans were not supposed to take a horse because that was like taking a Cadillac, you know.
Yeah.
That was too expensive for a Franciscan. But he did walk thousands of the 14,000 miles he did in the New World.
What was his first mission that he built?
That would be Mission San Diego. That was founded in 1769, which was shortly after they walked into Mission Bay from Baja.
And that's where, isn't it, the Comanche and the Apaches were having problems?
Well, the Apaches, actually, he was supposed to go to Texas. This is not known by a lot of people, but Serra was supposed to spell some Franciscans who were martyred on the Texas border of New Spain by Apaches or and Comanches. He was supposed to go there, but at the last minute it was canceled. And it's not quite clear why. He didn't, and he wanted to go. He had this anxiousness to be martyred, go straight to heaven. But he was relieved of that task, and thank God for it, because that mission in San Antonio, near San Antonio, was never built again.
He was not an easy man. Mm-mm. I mean, I do not think he would have been a person one would choose to work for.
Tough taskmaster.
Yeah.
Absolutely.
And on himself as well, you have to say.
Oh, yes.
He also was, which is the thing that is put under his name, he liked to flog himself and people, other people who worked for him.
Yeah, this is the dark spot in Sarah's life story. It's something, unfortunately, you can't avoid. You have to talk about it. The self-flogging or the self-flagellation, which was called the disciplina, the use of a flail, was very common in the church at that time as a way to mortify the flesh as Christ did.
Isn't it still being used in some cases?
Almost never. The church frowns on it today. I did talk to one or two Franciscans at Santa Barbara Mission who had done it in the late 40s, but I think that's when it sort of died out. The church considers such things today to be self-mutilation. That's a sin, so it's just not done. But the other, and of course so is flogging, it's cruel and unusual punishment, and was recognized as such by even the Spanish government and was outlawed around 1820, which is about 30 years after Sarah dies. Yeah. But during his time, he used it as a penitential measure for Indians who had stolen or had run away from the mission without permission, adultery, other things of that sort, murder. Don't forget, they were on a frontier. There was almost no legal authority except for a handful of soldiers at each mission. I think at 1.6 was the limit. So there wasn't a lot of discipline. I don't think it validates it. I think the flogging was wrong, and I say so in the book.
Who is it? The president of the missions was not Sarah. It was a man whom at times he respected, and at times he went against.
Yes.
One of those being the flogging of Indians.
Yes.
Because at that point, Spain did not allow slavery.
Right. No, Spain was fairly early in outlawing it, earlier certainly than the United States or England. The problem, and there was, in the 18th century, the Enlightenment, there was an attempt to do away with these arcane medieval practices in the colonies. On the other hand, let us say that for sure that there was still the comandantes and the secular government, the governor, such as Neve in Monterrey, actually they weren't abolishing flogging. They were taking it to themselves. They wanted to hold the discipline themselves and not the Franciscan fathers. I think it was a power struggle, frankly, Connie, over the issue of flogging.
Sarah's is part of the Franciscans.
Yes.
Yeah, but there were also the Loyolans.
The Jesuits.
And the Jesuits.
The Jesuits would be the followers of Loyola, Ignatius Loyola. They're Jesuits, yeah.
And there was not always peace between those two tribes.
Well, I mean, the Franciscans would have never come to California if the Jesuits hadn't been thrown out of Baja by the King of Spain, by the way.
Let me hold up this picture of Sarah as a young man. Where was this painted?
Well, we think that painting was done in 1773 in Querétaro, which is to the west of Mexico City, northwest of Mexico City. When he was on his way back from a meeting with the viceroy, who of course ruled over all of New Spain, including California, Sarah had gone back to Mexico City to get the comandante fired, because the comandante was not disciplining soldiers who were violating the Indian women. Yeah. So Sarah, in a way, I mean, we have to be fair here. The floggings mm-hmm. we think are reprehensible. But on the other side, he risked his life to defend the Indians against the soldiers who were raping them. Mm-hmm. So he wins the battle. Viceroy Booker, he says, I want Comandante Fajes fired, and I want soldiers coming up that are married so that mm-hmm. they're not, you know, subject to these crazy temptations, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. And he won. Mm-hmm. And on the way back, I guess he was feeling pretty good, and we think he sat for this painting by José de Pais.
But there is also the picture of him when the day before he is dying.
Yeah.
And that is...
that's a classic.
Quite a classic. I'm sorry it's not in color.
Black. Well, it is in color in the original. Wish we could have printed it in color. Mm-hmm. It hangs in the Mallorcan City Hall.
Uh-huh.
We're here in the Santa Monica City Hall. So the version in Mallorca of the City Hall, no one had actually reprinted it that I know of mm-hmm. until I believe it was in the exhibit at the Huntington mm-hmm. where I first saw it.
Yeah.
And I was glad for that. It was a great exhibit. And I quickly rushed to my editor and said, can we get permission to reprint this? Because no one's seen it in a book before.
And there is another man whose life he had been involved with. The name Lattes, is that it?
In the painting?
Yeah,
There's Palo, his friend. And then to the left is Fajes, or it looks like Fagus.
Right. Yeah.
They pronounce it in Spanish, Fajes. Yeah, he's sort of his nemesis.
Yeah.
And he appears in this painting. And if you look closely, Connie, I don't know if we can show the viewers, but...
Yeah, wouldn't get closer. Yeah,
as close as you can get to the Palo picture, look above his right shoulder, and it's a picture of an Indian. There's an mm-hmm. Indian in that painting.
Yeah. How did you get involved with this? I mean, what was the catalyst for you to say, I have to figure you gave a lot of your life to the book?
12 years.
Only, yeah.
Yeah, only 12. I've had 9 books published, thank God, but I've never given this amount of time. Good question. I've been asked it, and I never seem to give a proper response, but I'll try. I think in a way, Sarah left home to go home. Mm-hmm. If you see Mallorca, have you ever been there?
No.
Connie? If you go to Mallorca, you will see the mountains straight up from the ocean. You will feel the dry air and the palms along the coast, the rocking. Mm-hmm. You'll think you're in California.
Yeah.
So in a way, he left home to go home. And in a way, I think I did the same thing with this book.
Mm-hmm.
I left home at 17, and I was a native California. I was born and raised 3rd and Alvarado at St. Vincent's Hospital downtown. I'm a Californian in every sense of the term, I think. And yet, I lived half my life in the East after mm-hmm. going to college at Georgetown. So I always felt I was an exile in the East. I never took.
Mm-hmm.
And I thought, how am I going to get back home? And one thought came to my mind. I couldn't get Sarah's story out of my head over the years. I try to explain that he was as important as George Washington mm-hmm. and people at Jamestown to the nation's history. They said, Sarah, are you talking about Abraham's wife in the Old Testament, Sarah? I said, no, that's not the right Sarah. Did he fight with Pancho Villa on the border? I said, no, there's no Sarah that did that. They don't know a thing about Sarah in the East. So I thought, I'm going to write this book to go home.
Yeah. Well, I have to confess, I knew, all right, I'd go to San Diego, or San Juan Capistrano, and you knew there was a little sign that said Junipero Serra,
mm-hmm.
or there was a statue.
Sure.
And everybody knew the statue of him sort of with the brown coat.
Right.
But that was it. I didn't know the man. I didn't know that he was also maybe an architect.
Yes.
Because in this picture,
good point.
Talk about what he arranged.
Yeah. If we can see that picture, there is a theory of an archaeologist at Cal State University Monterey Bay, Ruben Mendoza, that Sarah and the priests who followed him,
mm-hmm.
Father Fermin Lasuen, did the last 9 did 9 of the last 18, that Lasuen and Sarah and a few others fixed the missions or adjusted them in such a declination that they faced the sun at key moments of the solar year, the summer solstice and the winter solstice, which were holy days to the Indians, and that he wanted to appeal to them. He tried in many ways through music, art, and even architecture, as you say, Connie, to show them, you know, what we believe and what you believe are not always at odds.
Yeah.
The sun may be one way to unite us.
I love that story. There's another one that my guest talks about in his youth. And I have to say, what happened to that girl who was a nurse?
Oh, you're the first person to catch that. You mean one of my early introductions into Mexican culture, huh? Yeah, I say in the afterword of the book that one of my first real introductions to the missions was a trip I took with a beautiful Mexican girl, Fabiola Lopez Ponce. I'd sure like to find out if she's still alive.
All right.
I don't know. The short answer is I'm not sure.
Mostly because she, you describe, and the experience, and I don't know your wife's name. So, I mean, that's the thing as a reader. I'm reading, now did he marry? What happened?
Yeah, I didn't meet my wife till many years later. My wife's name is Eileen, by the way.
Mm-hmm.
Fabiola was studying to be a nurse at Santa Monica City College, actually, right here, now that I think about it. And I was 24. I didn't get married for 10 more years. But for a year, we went together. And then I went up to Alaska for a graduate degree, of all things, and she thought I was crazy.
In what?
Creative writing. Mm-hmm. Took an MFA in creative writing. She says, what are you doing? It's not proper for you to be in such cold weather.
Oh, but Alaska is one of those places. Maybe you could understand Sarah going from place to place. I love Alaska.
Oh, it's gorgeous.
Yeah.
It's otherworldly. Yeah, you're right. In a way, I've always been something of a wayfarer or wanderer, kind of like Sarah. But I lost track of her, and in fact, when I got back after a year or two of graduate work, she was no longer here.
Yeah.
And she was from La Paz, which is at the tip or close to the tip of Baja.
Well, then let's go on to why is Sarah still a saint in waiting? And how many years?
Yeah.
And even the book that you use as reference, 31 years in writing.
Yeah, good catch there, Connie. Well, first let's take the sainthood issue. Technically, the church requires a necessary condition of two authorized or validated miracles. And when I say authorized or validated, you know, sometimes dozens of claimants come in and say, in fact, there are dozens already for a second miracle that haven't been approved. So the church is pretty hard on these things. I think 2,000 years ago they weren't so hard.
Yeah.
And you had hundreds of saints from the early days having what they called red martyrdom, which is that you died for your beliefs. That's not necessary now, but you still need these two miracles. There is one.
Yeah.
Logged in his name. It occurred, I think, in 1960 in St. Louis. But the second one has not yet been approved.
How did they find miracles for these three popes that they have just made saints?
Well, that's a good question. I believe that Francis I just canonized John Paul II. And, John the 23rd, who started the Vatican II. I may be wrong about this, but one of the two of them, I think it might be John Paul II. There aren't the two miracles. He kind of gave a dispensation on that one. Why, I don't know. To be honest, if it can be done with one, you wonder if it can be done with others. But, you know, all I know is that with Sarah, they're being particularly hard. There are others that are out waiting in the wings. Oscar Romero, the cardinal who was assassinated in El Salvador when he was taking up the cause of the poor in the 80s.
Mm-hmm.
He's a candidate for sainthood. Dorothy Day, the great head of the Catholic Workers in New York, is also being considered. Mother Teresa, who also, you know, has her own controversies. And then there's Sarah. You know, people ask me all the time, do you think he was a saint? which is the toughest question of all. I always say, and I kind of stand with it now, I know I felt he was holy.
Mm-hmm.
That I can say for sure.
He was definitely
unusually gifted and inspired man who sacrificed his safety many times, was willing to die for the Indians, got them released when they rebelled against San Diego, killed three people, killed one of his fellow priests in 1775, and the Commandante wanted to kill all the prisoners. And he wrote the Viceroy and said, I want them all released.
Yeah.
Because if we don't, we've lost our reason to be here.
Yeah. Have you become an officer of the church? Have you become one of the people who are sort of made special?
Yeah. You mean myself or
you?
Well, you know, I think in writing the book, you take a responsibility on, no doubt about it. I'm not an officer in the church, so to speak, but I guess I'm a voice now. I'm not qualified to say whether he should be a saint or not. What I try to do at the end of the book is put all the evidence for it and maybe a couple of things against it. Let the reader decide. I will tell you, in all honesty, you know, as far as the church goes, some people, I like to think the majority of Catholics at least, really love the book. There are some very right-wing Catholics, strangely enough, that don't. But I didn't write the book just for Catholics.
Mm-hmm.
And I didn't write the book just for Californians.
Yeah.
It's for us as a country.
Right.
It's an alternate story of the foundation of our country by a Franciscan.
And also the fact that as the European soldiers, even members of the church, came into Indian territory.
Right.
They were carrying disease, epidemics.
Yes.
That completely devastated tribes.
Oh, it's just, it is. It's the great tragedy of all of colonial affairs in the New World.
Yeah.
And California was not exempt.
Yeah. Because I do know, I've had, a Miwok Indian was his background.
Have you?
And he gave me one of their little woven sort of leather thing.
Oh,
and
lovely.
He said, this is very special.
Huh.
Because the Miwoks now are down to such a small tribe.
They were down to just minuscule numbers. They're back up to 1,000, which is still not many.
Yeah.
You know, there were many tens of thousands or close to 10,000 in the old days. They exist, I think, north of San Francisco, Connie, along the coastal region.
Monterey area.
Their baskets are very treasured, aren't they? That's really nice.
I guess I have.
You're lucky to have that. Yeah,
but,
very much so.
How many places did you visit all of the missionaries that are left?
I went to 20 of the 21 missions, some of them many times.
Yeah.
But there was one I missed, and I went to it after the book was published with Luke, my youngest son.
Yeah.
Mission Santa Ynez.
Uh-huh.
Which I recommend to you.
I will try to get there, but I think I should tell our friends, you found recently letters that had been written by Sarah.
Yes.
And how did you know they were there?
Well, some of it is luck and some of it is just, you know, hard, crazy perseverance. What does Robert Frost say about poetry? 10% inspiration, 90% perspiration.
Yeah.
I think it's the same with writing the book and trying to find original primary sources.
But how? I mean, that it had lasted this long.
Yeah.
That the ink hadn't dried.
Yeah.
That the papers didn't...
Was still there.
Do you know, even within our world that we're taping...
Yes.
There was a period, about 20 years ago, where it was taped on 3/4-inch tape.
Oh,
that
yeah,
today it would be disintegrated.
Oh,
that's
yeah.
why I'm thinking in terms of how... That's a miracle. You know
yes.
what? That's the
that's
miracle
That's a good point.
Me.
Yeah, it yeah. is. That it didn't disintegrate. Very true. And here, the one I found in San Pedro Escanella, which is a tiny village in the Mexican mountains, the Sierra Gorda, I was frustrated because I hadn't found anything in a couple weeks that was new, and I asked one of the people in the mountain village of Halpan, is there no museum, is there no place that might have just some original material? Sarah was here for 18 years, and the man got on the phone, and he said, I know someone in San Pedro who's going to take you in a car to San Pedro Escanilla. And we went down into the gorge, and sure enough, there was this little stone building that was no bigger than the enclosure we're sitting in right now. They had found 14 items, including a letter of Sarah's, in a farmhouse 6 months earlier. The farmer didn't even know what it was worth.
Yeah.
And including some other letters from his best friend, Francisco Palo. And they were all in this little, and I was the first researcher there.
Where are they now?
They're still in this tiny village.
Priceless.
Yeah.
Gregory, thank you. Will you autograph my book?
Connie, my pleasure.
Thank you. And if you'd like to know what else we've been reading, visit www.conniemartinson.com. You can read our columns from the Beverly Hills Courier. And go to YouTube, because this show will be on in YouTube within 2 weeks. Meanwhile, support your local library. Libraries are our finest democratic institution in America. Wherever you go, you can go in, get a card, and take out a book and bring it back in the condition you got it in. So support it, and we'll see you next time. Thank you so much.
My pleasure. Thank you, Connie.